the Son, the Holy Spirit, one God, to whom is the glory forever. Amen. It is really my pleasure to be among friends here in the Church of St. Mark. They all know, especially the volleyball team, that I have a very special place in my heart for, and I mean it. Maybe some people don't understand the joke, but it's real. The volleyball team understands it pretty well. At least we make it worthwhile. I hope to see them all after the sermon. This is a guarantee that they have to stay in the sermon. At least I can get some advantage out of the league that we can have a spiritual relationship together. Today, the eve of Wednesday, of the great Pascha week, and I feel always that it's almost difficult to depart from the theme of the day. The theme of the day is about wedding. It's about a relationship, a very close relationship. If you want to understand the crown of a relationship between a man and a lady, this relationship is crowned eventually with a relationship on the altar. Sure. I can go back. As we get the computer set up, let me share with you a song from the Songs of Solomon, a relationship between two people who love one another. And this relationship is really what we have today as God loves me. So think of not somebody you have emotional attachment to, but rather the Lord who wants to have an emotional attachment with you. It says, let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. Thank you very much. With the kisses of his mouth. More delightful is your love than wine. This is the Lord is telling you this. The Book of Songs of Solomon is not a relationship between two humans, it's a relationship between God and you. When does God kiss you? Really, kiss you with his mouth? When you take communion. When you come into communion, when you come into the inner chamber here, you hear about it in the Book of Songs of Solomon, this is not any unholy insinuation by the Bible. Of course, the Bible is very, very pure, but he represents it as a relationship between a man and a woman. That man is the Lord, and the lady is your soul. So the Lord wants to kiss you. He kisses you literally in the communion when you open your mouth and take him inside you. So let's repeat this verse. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth. More delightful is your love than wine, somebody who's intoxicated in love. Your name spoken is a perfume. I'm not getting words for myself. This is the words of Songs of Solomon. Your name spoken is a spreading perfume. Once it gets dropped, the whole aroma fills the room. Once we enter the church, we smell the incense, we see the other people who are in love with God. We call them the saints on the iconostasis. And then we spend the time with him in smelling the incense and seeing the altar. And eventually we have this amazing hug where I melt in God. And this is in the communion. He hugs me and I hug him. He abides in me and I abide in him. As he tells us in St. John chapter 6 verse 55. Let me actually quote these verses. In John 6:53, it says, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. The source of life happens behind this curtain. And I mean curtain, not a veil. My body is food indeed. My blood is drink indeed. The one who eats my body and drinks my blood abides in me and I in him. We hug one another so much that we melt into one another. He abides in me as a cell in my body, and I abide in him. Let's continue the love story. In verse 4, I'm all in chapter 1. Chapter 1, verse 4. That is why the maidens love you. This is the wise versions as opposed to the foolish versions. So please keep your oil ready all the time so that you can be in love with God. We will follow you eagerly. Yareet, we hope so. We always search for him. Then the lover inquires, what if you disappear from me? Where do I find you? Tell me, see the strong words. This is a jump to verse 7, chapter 1, verse 7. Tell me, you whom my love, my heart loves. Tell me, you whom my heart loves. This is he. Where you pasture your flock? Where do you sit with the sheep? Where are you? I want to spend time with you. Where you give them rest at midday when the sun is very strong, when there is so much tribulations, when there is so much confusion in my life, where can I find you? Lest I be found wandering after the flocks of your companions. So he answers as follows in verse 8. If you do not know, if you can't find me, O most beautiful among women, God does not get shy with words of love to you. When you enter into the church in the liturgy or in the liturgical Pascha, for example, although there is no communion, but you're all having the Lord in your heart, he calls you this way, and it's going to get better even chapter 2, the love story, the love relationship. O most beautiful among women, follow the tracks of the flock. If you can't find me, you can follow, I say it in a colloquial way, if your whole week you messed up completely, just to follow the cars, where do they go on Sunday? And they lead you to me, they lead you to communion. The cars that of the people who can come and pick you up, the cars of servants who may text you, let's go to the liturgy, the cars of parents who may go ahead of you to the church. So if you do not know where I sit, O my beloved, O my most beautiful among women, follow the tracks of the flock and pasture the young ones near the shepherd's camps. Sometimes we lose sight of God and we need direction. And this is what he's telling us. This is a love story that started in paradise and it continues in communion, continues in the liturgy. The liturgy is not just the way we worship. The liturgy is the way we have a love story with God. Paradise had liturgy. When Adam and Eve were created, it had a liturgy. Because liturgy means participation with God. It is not just I'm standing, singing, and then at the end I eat something and they call it the body and the blood of the Lord, and then I have a social activity afterwards. No. He calls you beautiful. He wants to hug you. He wants to kiss you. What about my prayer? Oh, your prayer, as soon as you open your mouth in prayer, no matter how you are, but if you want to repent and you open your mouth in repentance to God, as St. Peter, after delivering Christ, he wept bitterly. The Lord answers you the following verse. Remember this verse from today. Songs of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 10. My lover speaks. He says to me, arise, my beloved, my beautiful one, and come. Lord, but I'm dirty, I'm filthy. It's okay. Arise, my beloved, my beautiful one, and come. As soon as he hears your voice, he cannot contain himself. So if you're sitting on bed and you're just talking to God, he's telling you, come, I am ready to hear you. I am ready to hug you. I'm ready to clean you. I am ready to receive you. I am ready to renew the relationship. First, chapter 2, verse 10. So when we were created at the very beginning, Adam and Eve were married because Eve was created from Adam, and this is the marital relationship. Not two people from dust. One person from dust being in the image and likeness of God, that's Adam, and woman taken from man because they are becoming one flesh. They have access to one another. They have a marital relationship. And they were attending liturgy every day. God was talking to them, they were talking with him, and they have access to what is called the tree of life. In Genesis 1:26, he's telling us, let us create man in our image and our likeness. And let him have dominion of everything. So we are gods, we are in the image of God. God is free will, he has free will, so we do. He is dominating, so we do. He gives us authority over everything in the creation, and he's eternal, so we are. So you are gods. For gods to live eternally, they have to feed off God. And that's why there's nothing that will make you live except what we offer behind this curtain. If you are gods, and this is the term that Christ used, I'm not going to elaborate on it, how can you live forever? You have to have God himself inside you. And this is why he told them in Genesis 2:9, behold, there's the tree of life in the middle of the garden. Have access to it as much as you can. But as the devil plants bad stuff, he planted another tree called knowledge of good and evil. It has to be by the devil, because God does not plant evil things. Don't have access to it. So we're presented with this love relationship. There is no pressure to sin. There is loving God every day. There is the nakedness of Adam and Eve. They have relationship with one another. There is no shame. There is no sin. Just love. Love and communication and access to communion. The tree of life is communion. So the liturgy did not start in the New Testament. The liturgy started once we were created. Then we damage everything. And the Lord wants to hug us back inside him. So he came and did this to himself. I am the tree of life. I have to give them myself. What do you give them? I give them the source of life forever. That's the blood. There's so many verses in the Bible about the life being in the blood, the soul of the animal in animal sacrifice in the blood. But I don't want to water this down. I just want to focus on Christ. So he did this to himself in order for you to have access again. When you come into the church, you can go through the altar to the tree of life. He is there himself. The tree of life is the Lord himself. And this is what really brings us to the eve of Wednesday. The wedding garment. What do we wear when we come to the church? And I mean to have access to communion. I'm not talking about the dressing, but I'm talking about what garment you should have on in terms of the church sacrament. We'll come to this. The bride's oil, the groom's entrance, the rejected bride, may God protect us all from this, and the wise bride. In the first hour, it's the wedding garment, and that's your baptism. It is not a check mark, oh, you have communion, you have to be baptized, you have to have the Holy Spirit. And this is not rituals of Christianity. Believe me, if you understand it, it's so simple. The concept is very, very clear. I'm going to have God inside me. Lightness and darkness cannot mix. So I have to become light only. So that's why I get baptized. Those who have been baptized in Christ, put on Christ. All of you, you don't dress normal dresses or normal code of garments. You have put on Christ. Wherever you go, you're enveloped in Christ. That's the wedding garment. That's what you have on. That's what can never be taken away from you. Okay, now I'm clean. But I'm still human. I'm now a clean human that can have access to the kingdom of heaven. John 3:3 and John 3:5 support this when the Lord Jesus Christ was discussing with Nicodemus. Then, in order to make me infinite, so that God can dwell inside me, he said, I'm going to seal you with the Holy Spirit. Now I'm not a small human, I'm infinite. The Lord Jesus Christ was also infinite, can dwell in me. Hence the church says you have to be baptized, you have to be chrismated. This is not rituals, this is just to make you eligible for that banquet, eligible for that, to have the wedding garment. You cannot access the wedding. You cannot have this kissing relationship with the Lord where he kisses you and you kiss him in the communion. And I mean that very, very deep. Because the Lord knows we're human, and he feels that this is, how can I get to my children how much I love them? I kiss them all the time. Then, now I can have the Lord inside me, because now I have the wedding garment. Unfortunately, I want to hit this home very strongly. The liturgy is not a way Orthodox or Catholic people or apostolic people worship. The liturgy is the way to live paradise, the way the Lord intended it. And when we damaged it, the very next day, the Lord was planning the liturgy of the New Testament to give us access again, because we had it before, to the Tree of Life. Let's delve into the wedding garment. In Revelation 19, after the fall of the strong immorality goddess is Jezebel, and she was riding the beast, and the beast was floating over nations, like everybody will swim in sin, drinking sin like water, and because of the abundance of sin, the love of many will grow cold. Hosara. Hosara, that we're missing. We want love. Everybody seeks love. Everybody wants to be loved. Everybody wants a relationship in love. But then we find it in places where it does not give love. It gives hunger. It excites maybe lust more than love. It excites taking more than giving. So the Lord is telling us in Revelation 19, I'm going to have a banquet for you when I come, but I want you all to be dressed. And in Revelation 19 says that the dress code is the virtues of the saints. So for you to be able to make it to the banquet of the Lamb, you have to be covered with good deeds. And this is why we say, okay, if you are baptized and you are sealed by the Holy Spirit to become, all of you are infinite humans. You're not small. You're not occupying the volume you are in front of God. You're all huge, that the Lord can live inside you. And this is why our worship is Trinity. I have the Lord inside me, my lover who kisses me all the time. I am sealed with the Holy Spirit, and I stand and say, our Father who art in heaven. I am a Trinity, worshiping a Trinity. Christ, it's called the wedding of the Lamb because we are in an engagement period now. Because you can break the engagement, it's up to you. St. Paul says this in 2 Corinthians, that I have engaged you to one husband as a chaste virgin to Christ. So when will the wedding happen fully, where it's unbreakable? By your choice, when you reach chapter 19 of Revelation, it's the wedding of the Lamb. Christ is a lamb slaughtered on the cross. The ring of the wedding, as the priest prays on it, in order to invoke that this is a sign of unbroken seal between two people that become one flesh. They are no longer two, but one flesh. For us to become one with Christ, he had to be whipped. If you count the number of whips or the number of strikes that has been on his body from the shroud, this is something we're very involved in its research and in preparing for presentation for Good Friday. If you count the number of the whips on Christ from the shroud front and back, there's about 124 bruises on his body. The most amount of blood comes from the head. And you can see very, very clearly that he is sealing the relationship with blood. And he wants you to drink that blood. Not in a carnivorous way, but rather as an engagement. That I'm going to kiss Christ all my life. A wedding is a new life. That's why in the ninth hour of Tuesday, we read three chapters, 7, 8, and 9 of Genesis, the story of Noah. Because the Lord is telling everything will be new. I will baptize you, that's the symbol of the flood, and I will create with these eight people a new life. The cross is joyful. It has been given to you not only to believe in him, but to suffer for his sake. Please do not focus on the suffering as something that God is punishing you. God is actually very, very sweet in this. And a verse I want you to remember also, the first one was chapter 2, verse 10. I want to mention this one now. Chapter 2, verse 6 of the Love of Solomon. His left hand is under my head, and his right arm embraces me. Can you imagine the position? The Lord is holding my head like this, and with his right hand, he's wrapping me. And this is how God sees me. He's just ready to carry my head and embrace my body. Two verses before this, to prepare for this one, he brings me into the banquet hall. That's the liturgy. And his emblem over me is love. That's my crown. Strengthen me with raisin cakes. Refresh me with apples, for I am faint with love. I am so loving him that as Saint Anthony was like upset with the sun when he's praying. When he prays all night and the sun comes up in the morning, it mentions about him by Saint Athanasius that he fights with the sun. Why did you appear and hide from me the real sun, the Lord Jesus Christ? His left hand is under my head and his right arm embraces me. In Matthew chapter 22, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a certain king who made a marriage for his son. You are very special to God. The marriage is what he prepares for you by his blood every liturgy. Then he said to his servants, the wedding is ready, but they which were bidden were not worthy. Khusara. This is, the Lord goes very, very far in thousands of years preparing for me the love story of, and then he gives it to me in the body and the blood, and then sometimes I find something that delays me from coming. May God help us all, we don't delay, and we stand under the cross, as you're all here in the Pascha, in order to associate with God during the week. And when the king came in to see the guests, he saw there was a man that did not have the wedding garment. What is the wedding garment? In Revelation 19:8, and to her the soul, which is the wife of the Lamb, that's you, the Lord, the wife of Christ, our soul that is, was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white, for the fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. The fine linen is the righteousness of the saints. And he, the angel, said unto me, St. John, write. What do you want me to write? Well, something huge. Blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he said unto me, these are the true sayings of God. And when God says something, it is true. Sometimes people think before the wedding, whom do we invite? Min hayezal, min mishatroh la invitation. And there's a huge issues about the invitations of weddings. I don't care much about it. I think this is the one that you've already been invited to. The Lord is so happy to, as he said, sit down and serve you in this banquet. So care about this one. This is the marriage that you really ought to have before the earthly marriage. They're both related. Next one, the bride's oil. The prophecy Amos says, see good and not evil. Where is your goal? What do you plan during the day when you open your calendar and you put dates in it? Your outings, your phone calls, your texts, your relationship. Does it apply to this litmus test? See good and not evil, that you may live. And so the Lord, the God of hosts, shall be with you. As ye have spoken, hate the evil and love the good. This will make it easier to be with God if you just don't like sin. It takes with a little bit initially with self-control, then it becomes automatic. It becomes really in your system. And establish judgment in the gate. What is the gate? That's your heart. Your heart should have doors. Should not be like an open field. Anybody can go in, anybody can leave. It should have a gate like the Temple of Solomon. It had gates on all sides. One of them actually was called the Beautiful Gate. And the gate on the east, the Muslims were thinking, because we have in our religion in the seventh century. It's just a digression about the literal meaning when they know that Christ is coming from the east. So in the 7th century, the Muslims blocked the east gate. They just shut it down as if Christ this way can't come in. He can actually go over the wall. It's just very basic. Yeah, if he finds that gate. Anyway. Nas in darkness. Nas khusar, yani this is souls that the devil is acquiring. We should be zealous about them. It may be that the Lord God of hosts will be gracious unto the remnant, the leftover. You have always leftover. The leftover is you. when you have exasperated all your energy in away from God, there is always left over, and there is always the Holy Spirit inside you. He can make out of a very small yeast or a very small lump of bread a huge amount of food. Feeding the multitude is an evidence. The Lord is just wanting us to be careful from the leaven of the Pharisees, and that is hypocrisy. So the Lord will be gracious, and whatever is left over inside you, He can enlarge it. Blessed is the man whom you chose, and He chose all of you. This is an open invitation. You all have access to the tree of life. No hindrance. The hindrance comes from you, not from the Lord. And cause to approach unto you, that you may dwell in your courts, that He may dwell in your courts. That's the church. We shall be satisfied with the goodness of your house, even of your holy temple. The bride's oil in Matthew 24, but as the days of Noah were, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For as in the days that were before the flood, they were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage. All what they cared about was the body, the flesh. Until the day that Noah entered into the ark, that was the end. So, similarly, the second coming will be, and the Lord is so open with mercy now, because He knows that the devil is strong, and He knows that the temptation is strong, and He knows that we fall. Actually, remember this verse if you fall, Micah 7:8. Micah 7:8. So I want you to remember second chapter of Songs of Solomon, second chapter, verse 10. If you remember, verse 6 is the love position between me and God, as He's ready always to hug me and kiss me. And in Micah 7:8, there is a verse that tells us, "Do not mock me, my enemy, for if I fall, I will stand up again, and the light of the Lord will shine upon me. I am assured. Do not mock me, my enemy, for if I fall, I will stand up again, and the light of the Lord will shine upon me." Whatever condition you're in, as soon as you have even committed sin, shout in the face of the devil and tell him, "Don't laugh at me. I know you got me this time. But I know that I can stand up again. And once I stand up again, definitely the Lord will have His light on me." Where is that verse? Very good. No, Micah 7:8. And I lakbatuku khals. Songs of Solomon 2:10 and Micah 7:8. You don't have to remember anything else. Just you can sleep through the rest of the sermon if you want. The groom's entrance, maybe after this hour, after this one is important. Maybe the 9th and the 11th, it's okay. The prophecy, God wants you to be attached to Him. Jeremiah 13, "For as the girdle cleaves to the loins of a man, so have I caused to cleave unto me the whole house of Israel." I want to have you wrapped around me. "And the whole house of Judah." The two kingdoms were divided already. Israel in the north, Judah in the south. That's after Solomon, in the time of Rehoboam, got divided by Rehoboam being in the south and Jeroboam being in the north. So the Lord wants to wrap you around. Wherever He goes, you're attached to Him. "Says the Lord, that they might be unto me for a people and for a name and for a praise and for a glory. But they would not hear." Sorry, Rab. Sorry, our Lord, sometimes we are disappointing you. The gospel, very, very fitting to have it, the five wise versus the five foolish versions. St. Augustine says, "Whoever abstains from unlawful seeing, unlawful hearing, unlawful smelling, unlawful tasting, and unlawful touching, by reason of his righteousness, receives the name a virgin." Spotless. Diana al-Naqiyya and Allah Hazih. This is in St. James chapter 1. The true religion for God is this. Number one, visiting widows and orphans in their distress. Number two, to keep yourself spotless. This verse exactly, or this saying of the Father. St. Augustine is just a perfect example of complete darkness to complete light, to become a bishop after being unlawfully in a relationship and having a son out of wedlock. And then he becomes a bishop. This is the mercy of God incarnate, basically. So let's abstain from unlawful seeing, unlawful hearing, unlawful smelling, unlawful tasting, unlawful touching, By reason of being righteous, then you deserve the term virgin, being spotless, even if you've been completely spotted. St. Augustine about the oil and the lamps again, being ready all the time. The girded waist is virginity. The burning lamps are good works. The oil is God's gift of our conscience. Being your conscience is alive. St. Paul tells us very proudly, for our boasting is in this, the testimony of our conscience, that in front of God I am really trying to repent. The rejected bride, these are the Pharisees. Actually, I'll skip this. This is just our condition if we're away from God. Let's go to the wise bride. In wisdom, if you are wise, this is the how valuable wisdom is. She is more beautiful than the sun and excels every constellation of the stars. Compared with the light, she is found superior. For it, the sun, basically, is followed by night, succeeded by night, but against wisdom, evil does not prevail. There is no end to wisdom. There is no, oh, this is after this amount of wisdom, I can lose it. The sun even gets hidden from us because of the rotation of the earth, but the wisdom never gets hidden from us. Day and night, you have the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the wisdom. So we go into our knees and tell God, be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me. I have sinned, I have sinned. This is the response. What song that has, I have sinned in the liturgy? A response of what? There's a song in the liturgy that will say, I have sinned, I have sinned. Open choice, okay, what else? Weekdays, for there is no servant without sin and there is no master without forgiveness. The second paragraph, the first paragraph of the weekday liturgy response of the gospel, the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, may dwell in your hearts and minds in Jesus Christ our Lord. Second paragraph, I have sinned, my Lord Jesus Christ. There is no servant without sin, and there is no master who does not have forgiveness. And then our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Your kingdom is forever. If I'm quoting it not accurately. So the songs of the church is not just repeating some hymn, but it's really standing there. And I'm telling God, after reading the book of Acts in Coptic, because this is the response of the book of Acts, and then it gets explained in English or in Arabic, I am telling God, this is really my condition. I want, after the Bible, that after hearing your word, this is what comes to my mouth. I want you to know that I have sinned, and your character is forgiveness. You are the lover of mankind. Be merciful to me, O God, be merciful to me, for in you my soul takes refuge. In the shadow of your wings, I will take refuge until iniquity passes by. Imagine like the Matania, as if like there is a strong wind coming by, and you're bowing down just to let it go until God, I can't handle this. I can't face it. This is too much temptation for me. I will like just dunk, just go down. And this is as you're going down at the feet of Christ, so that the evil may pass by, and then you can stand up again. Don't face it. In the book of Revelations, when the bottomless pit is opened in chapter 9, we find that this army comes out, the locusts, and they come, they have hair like women and nice faces from a distance, and then when they come close, they have very, very strong teeth. And this is facing sin. Sin can really cut the person. So the Lord is telling us, just dunk in this time. Have the Matania position. Just stay under at the ground. Be humble. Go down till this evil passes by. Then you can stand up again. And this is the wisdom, like the wisdom of the serpents, that the Lord asks us to be wise as serpents and humble as doves. The serpent is excellent to know what war it can get in and what war it should retreat from. It is the wisdom to hide behind the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the light, he is the door, he is the way, he is the life, he is your Savior, and he is your lover. To him is the glory with his good Father and the Holy Spirit forever and ever. Amen.